Thank you for auditing Professor Sky's Record Review, the always positive new music review show hosted by a French professor who lives in Western New York. I say that because yet again, I'm going to be reviewing a rap artist from Buffalo, from Western New York. And listen, I do not represent my university in any way. I do not represent their views. I am not making these videos representing them in any way. But I will say that almost all of my students are from Western New York, are from Rochester, are from Buffalo. And the fact that there's so much great music coming from this part of the country actually gives me hope and makes me happy inside for the cultural vitality of this region where I ended up living, because it's really hard to get a job as a French professor. It really is. The amazing thing is that it turns out this artist, Chez Noir, has released 3 albums this year, and I somehow missed out on all of them. I mean, I must have saw them on the list, I maybe even listened to them and then decided I wasn't going to review, but this is a real testament to the vitality of hip-hop and the vitality of music right now, that we can have so much good music being made and produced that even somebody who intentionally listens to as much music as possible, like me, misses out on an artist this good and this interesting. Especially an artist this good and this interesting from the part of the world where they live. Now, even though one would say, oh, she's from Buffalo, so she must be part of Griselda, that's another testament to how vital Western New York is, that she's not even officially affiliated with Griselda. Although she does seem to be following their kind of spitfire, rapid release strategy of just album after album after album, she isn't a part of their crew, and I wouldn't even say that she fits particularly well. And this is what's interesting, you know? My initial take was like, okay, Buffalo releases lots of albums, has kind of a throwback feel, more focus on lyricism, not so much on singing and mumbling, no trap beats, like, you know, they're basically the same thing, but they really are extremely different because of the thematics. More and more I'm starting to think that the best way to divide different schools of hip-hop isn't with, like, political or gangsta or mainstream or indie, but more just materialist and non-materialist. That there are rappers who dedicate themselves to discussing the accrual of wealth, the spending of wealth, the meaning of wealth, the problems with wealth, having. And then there's the rest of the rappers, which is definitely in the minority, who, instead of rapping about having things, rap about doing things or being things, right? And Chez Noir is very much in this second camp. She doesn't rap about money. She doesn't rap about sex. She doesn't rap about crime. She doesn't rap about anything that is about sort of owning things. The entire album is really about her struggle to succeed as an artist, but not because she wants to be rich and dominate and be flashy, but because she is trying to make a living through her art. And if that sounds interesting to you, you should have a listen to this album. It really is quite good. Her rapping itself is, again, it's weird because I want to say that it's old school, but it's not old school, it's new school, right? It sounds like 90s rapping, which I think arguably is sort of the high point of lyricism in hip hop, sort of before the auto-tune revolution, before the trap and the mumble and everything. The late 90s is really when hip hop started to break out of the old school and get into this newer form of more interesting flows and more interesting lyrics. She's entirely in that vein all the way through. Extremely clear with all of her words. At times her flow isn't always there. Like, at times it seems as though her words are a little too written and not enough performed. So, like, that's, if I could say there's one thing, like, there is something about this EP that doesn't feel fully formed yet. It feels like she is an artist who has, like, 90% downloaded her excellence, but there's maybe this 10% that she needs to work on, especially with the flow. No matter what, this album deserves attention and respect because it is one of those rare feats of an artist who produces and raps the entire album. Now again, there just aren't that many rappers who do that. Okay, there's very, very few rappers who can rap and produce at the same time. And she does it on this entire EP. What's interesting is she uses a pseudonym for her production side. She calls herself She calls herself Marché Black. And so the whole thing must be this this play on French, as if I couldn't like her more, being from Buffalo. But her name, Chez Noir, I believe, is a shortening of Marché Noir, which means black market in French. And so I don't know why she has two different names for the production side and the rapping side, but her beats are really impressive. They're really well made. They're very consistent. They're not simplistic beats. They're mostly like chopped up 70s kind of soft soul samples, if that kind of makes sense to you. So like music you maybe wouldn't listen to get pumped up, but the way that it's mixed together. One thing that she does really well is she layers on top of her samples very nicely. So there might be like a sample kind of in the background, and then she'll reinforce it with some extra bass or reinforce it with some extra drums just to keep going. So it's a very impressive album. I'm gonna go through it track by track. I'm gonna play a little bit of it as well. Apparently she is not under the Griselda umbrella, but she's under the 38 Spesh umbrella. And apparently that's the next artist who I need to get into, because he's actually from Rochester. I saw, while doing research, I watched him do a video where he was actually wearing the gear of my favorite minor league baseball team, which is in my hometown here. So that's kind of interesting and kind of funny. It is just amazing. And I think one thing this album seems to be very consistent on, and this is true of Griselda as well, these rap artists who are indie rap artists, who are not internationally or nationally known necessarily, who are talking about the fact that they're able to make a living by being a rapper. And there's something about that which is very different than I am so rich, count my stacks, count my stacks. Just like, I can make a living and you've never heard of me. That's basically the theme of this entire album. It's like, I'm so good at what I'm doing that no one knows who I am and I'm able to make a living. And I think that's an interesting theme, and I think it goes along really well with this general idea of just working and working and working. That's the main thing. She works a lot and she succeeds a lot. So the album begins with Foxy's intro, which is a cut from an old Pam Grier movie. I must have saw this movie like 15 years ago. You can find it on YouTube. You can just look up the quotes. Foxy Brown like cuts off the penis of this like evil, of this woman's boyfriend, and the woman's like this evil gang leader who's like trying to torture Foxy, and it's okay. I mean, it's an okay introduction. It doesn't quite fit the rest of the album, because the album doesn't feel like it's supposed to be blaxploitation, and I don't even really feel that Chez Noir is trying to adopt this kind of badass, you know, gun in the afro perspective or point. I mean, I think it's nice, but it doesn't seem to fit with the rest of the album that well. The album starts in earnest with the track Cruise Control, featuring The Mussolini, which is kind of a funny name. Again, self-produced, and she starts off the whole thing just says, we're going to have fun. And I think that's another thing about this album, is it's supposed to be a short, fun album to listen to, and indeed it is. Very cool kind of samples in the background, these kind of slinky voices going high and low. It almost sounds like a blaxploitation soundtrack, or even like a James Bond movie. And another one of the main themes is rapping about men's loyalty. But it's not loyalty in the sense of like, did you cheat on me? It's more like, are you there for me when I'm down? And a lot of this album is about somebody who feels that she's up, being disappointed with those who let her down when she was down. And it's really relatable, right? Because she's not talking about, you know, my Lamborghini has an oil leak, right? It's much more like, hey, how do I get people to stop disappointing me? Which is a pretty major theme. One funny thing that happens is that there's a hook on here, and that's the guy Mussolini, and he's just kind of rapping. And this sort of throws me back to, I don't know, maybe The Lox or something, just having a hook on a song be a not particularly great voice guy, just sort of talking through here. I'm gonna give you an idea of some of the lyricism on here, of what makes her a good lyricist. Only way you'll get the crown is if I sell it back. Kind of interesting idea. Being broke gave me nightmares. And then an example of what makes her writing good and bad is this one line. I'm just going to kind of take this as a microcosm, and this is maybe that 10% I was talking about. I bite my tongue so much that I can't taste what I'm eating. The way that she delivers this line and the way that she tries to rhyme it with the thing before, it's just a little clunky. I know I'm like dissecting here with a scalpel, and I really like this album a lot, and I really think you should listen to it, right? And I might be, you know, what do I know? I might be wrong here, but there's something about the way this line comes together that I think a line like this is where the improvement could be, and I don't know what it is because I'm not an MC, But still, like, this is where, like, the line is great. It's interesting. It's important because it's also a subtly feminist line as well, because often women in position of power feel they have to constantly bite their tongues in order to not be seen as too bossy, right? That's one of the big problems that feminism is trying to fight. So she's saying all these things, and she's saying them all at once, and it's a good line, but it just doesn't quite hit. Next track is called Hunger Games, and this is co-produced by 38 Spesh, apparently. Another kind of mournful beat. Most of the beats on this sound kind of sad. Again, more kind of high-pitched soul samples. But then when the drum, this is what I'm talking about. Like, they had these nice samples, but then the drums come in on this song. And when the drums come in, it's not some big bombastic thing. You know, here come the drums. But it's this subtle introduction of drums behind that just makes the whole song pop. It just becomes so much better. It's a really well-produced song. And here she talks about, I pray for wisdom more than I pray for money. Okay, so right off the bat, you know, this whole concept of materialist versus non-materialist, because my mind is the only thing that the crackers aren't taking from me. So, a couple references to Caucasian Americans as crackers, fair enough. And this sort of weird, like, occasional political stance, anti-racist stance, more like anti-racist white people stance, more like anti-white supremacy stance. Right, I mean societal white supremacy. Right, the structural white superiority that has been in place in our country since its beginning. She seems to be more about that, and this is a really interesting idea because she's saying that the money doesn't get you anything because the crackers will always take it from you. And I think it's really well said. I think it's a very efficient political statement. You know, it's just one line or two lines, but it's precise. It's a very precise cut. And I think it says it really well. And again, it's the thing that she's doing that I like is she's not saying, like, I don't rap about money. That's for fools. Instead, it's just more like, I would rather pray for wisdom. The guest appearances in general on this album are kind of, at their worst, they're boring. At their best, they're good. And sort of one of the themes of the album is reinforced by 38 Spesh on this track where he says, you know, you did it your way, I did it my way. My way made me a millionaire without getting airplay. And that's what this appears to be, just a world of millionaires who aren't getting any airplay. Next track is called Reasons. And, okay, listen. If someone is out there who knows where this sample comes from, would you please tell me? I tried Shazamming this sample. The main thing I try to do to find samples is that I take the lyrics and I put them in quotes and then I write lyrics. And usually the lyrics to the original song pop up, but I can't make out the lyrics to this song. It's like, if you're searching for the reason, and then it's like, pick the selfish thing I found. Did they say pick the selfish thing I've... I just couldn't find it. But it's a great kind of soft soul sample, you know, like kind of like cheesy synthesizers, and the way that it's used is just beautiful. Eventually they build up on this kind of thin sample that's sort of intentionally manipulated a little bit, sounds a little bit tinny, with you know, overdubs of the basic melody played by new keyboards that have a lot more strength and oomph to them. Really nice. And constantly talking about how she's never invested in money. And that's one of the great themes of the album. She gets pretty creative on this as well. She talks about how she's like Notorious B.I.G. and she talks about her success. And then she says that I stepped out on faith. And this is just a great, I mean, this is, there have been a lot of lyrics about the Notorious B.I.G. A lot of creative and witty lyrics. And I don't have the time to think about it now. I would love in the comments, could you please write to me your favorite lyrics about Notorious B.I.G.? But this is one of the smartest because she's talking about him and then she says, I stepped out on faith. So this is great because it means that she went out on her own based on her faith in a way, right? But then the joke is that Faith Hill was Notorious B.I.G.'s partner and he would cheat on her, so he stepped out on faith and she stepped out on faith. This kind of homonym, very funny. Jinx makes an appearance, another rapper I'd never heard of and I couldn't find any information about, but his rap is actually quite interesting, talking about having to bottle up your feelings. It's another theme in this album, I would say, is people who feel they have to keep things bottled up and not say what they really feel because people in society have more power than them, so they can't talk about it. The next track is called Divine Knowledge, and this is the only song with no guest appearance. So I really like this song for that reason. It feels a little bit extra special that it's just one human being with a computer and a brain making all this music. And what's really cool here, I'm gonna play you a little bit of the song in a second. I'm gonna play you after this kind of octave play comes in. So they have this nice sample in the background like usual. And then ding, 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 ding. I'm gonna come back. I'm just gonna play it for you, and then I'm gonna get to you with some of my theories about that later. So here's a great example of the music of Chez Noir, the song Divine Knowledge. So a lot of great things happening there. I don't know if this is intentional, but this reminds me a lot of the octave play in the song Boys in the Hood. Dink, 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 right? I don't know if that's intentional, but it feels a little bit like it because the song is sort of the absolute opposite of Boys in the Hood, because it's not talking about getting money, it's not talking about how to get rich, it's just talking about just the feeling of freedom and the feeling of accomplishment, the accomplishment of small success, the accomplishment of hustling and having some success. So I don't know. I think it's interesting because Megan Thee Stallion, the first of the three female rap artists who I've reviewed in the last couple weeks, she has a whole song called Girls in the Hood that's intentionally supposed to be like, what if it was Boys in the Hood, but it's girls? But it's really not that different. It's basically just the same idea, the same song, the same beat. Whereas this very much is very far away from the original. I don't know. That I'm probably just grasping at straws there, overanalyzing, as a professor likes to do. Her lyrics are quite nice here. I ain't a rookie rap chick on no pussy rap shit. Told me, take that lane, you could be rich. So it's one of the interesting things here where, I've been talking about, I just mentioned Megan Thee Stallion and I reviewed Shy Girl last week as well. This is a rare rap album, female-led rap album, where sex is nowhere, absolutely nowhere in the entire album. There's no reference to sexuality at all. There's less reference to sexuality in this than there is in 99.9% of male rap artists, okay? And I think this is a very intentional thing. I think it's part of what makes this album subtly powerful, right? Because she doesn't even spend that much time talking about not talking about it. But the expectation, even for the greatest female rappers and greatest female MCs, is that they're eventually gonna have to start talking about their genitals. I mean, what else are they supposed to talk about, right? That's the expectation. And she just kind of throws it out there. I ain't no rookie rap chick on no pussy rap shit. Like, she just kind of dismisses it and expresses herself and says people told her they could take that lane and be rich, but she avoided it. And this is my favorite thing about the album. This is my favorite line on the album by far. Last year, I was dead broke, starving with just my name. A year later, dropped a classic that charted at number 8. Why do I love this album so much? Because first of all, she's not doing the thing which I hate, which is like, before I rapped, I was rich, and now I'm rich, which I it's kind of a boring trope to me. So she's saying that she's poor, so that she lived in misery, and now she's bragging that she charted at number 8, okay? Number 8. Why do I love that? Because it's real, right? She didn't chart at number 1. I'd maybe heard her name, but I didn't know who she was, but she's succeeding by reaching number 8. This is a reasonable aspiration. This is not the great big American dream, okay, I'm reloaded, Scarface dream at all. This is just a year ago, she had nothing, she's working really hard, and now she's at number 8. Like, that's the true success. That is the true success of an artist, is having any recognition, being able to make a living from your art. It's great. Lots of great lyrics all the way throughout here about her hustle and her plans and about how COVID interrupted it, but she's still working at it. Has a whole thing at the end where she talks about you can't free yourself if you aren't aware that you're trapped, which I think is an interesting idea, that there's a connection between freedom and awareness. I think that's true. As a French professor who deals a lot with existentialism, awareness usually comes in understanding that you're not free, right? Like, there's no awareness that leads to freedom. There's just awareness of your own inability to be free. But I'm not going to get into that now. That then leads into the track Moment in the Sun, which is the most overtly political song. My biggest problem with the whole album is at the beginning, she just does a whoo, ha ha ha, and it just feels misplaced. It doesn't feel authentic. And then the whole song is like this really serious take on Black Lives Matter and racial inequality and social injustice. Again, going at crackers. But it's like, why do we have this sort of bizarrely carefree beginning to such a serious song? I don't know, but there's riots in the background. There is this whole kind of, there's lots of quotes from R.J. Payne, who's talking about, you know, don't call this a looting and all that. It's a very well-written song. It shows a lot of righteous anger, righteous indignation. And it does make me, you know, really, I'm really definitely been noticing over the last couple of years, this increase, this constant increase of politically conscious rap in mainstream and in indie rap, that it always has to be addressed. And it does feel like there is a shift in all rap music towards being more overtly politically conscious. And I think that's an interesting trend, which is probably a reaction to a bunch of unfortunate developments, but we'll get into that never. There's some great lines in here too. She says, some people lost their innocence to sex, I lost it to murder. Which is a beautiful and interesting line, talking about her innocence and the, again, emphasizing that she is not going to allow herself to be defined bisexuality, and making herself more interesting by sort of alluding to this story. A beautiful line all about how the Constitution says we are free, but they turn the loopholes into nooses. So, you know, I've been critical at times. You know, I've just criticized Jeff for going woo at the beginning of the song. Okay, but really, this is a beautiful line. I turn loopholes into nooses, right? That's what happened, loopholes in the Constitution turned into nooses, which allowed to the hurting, subjugation, and murder of people of color, right? Even more great lines. I can't relate to chess because I never had the same advantages as our opponents. Like saying the idea that as often many rap artists do, sort of comparing life to chess, that you can't actually do that when the playing board is so unfair. I think at one point she says, yeah, it's like the game of life, but the board is Jumanji. A guy named Sa Rock comes on to rap on here as well. Kind of interesting line. I don't need violence to entertain. F a couple dollars. I'm challenging to change, which is kind of a good line. And then ends with just piano and rapping, which is pretty brave. She's obviously producing herself, and so she's confident enough in her delivery to just rap without a drum beat and not rap a cappella, like rap with a piano. That's pretty tough, and she does it quite well. The album ends not quite as strong as the rest of it with a track called Grace. Has a very bizarre singing at the beginning. Someone sort of doing that sort of like over-singing R&B hip-hop thing, but the voice is a little bit cracked, which makes it interesting. Even more about avoiding sex for money, talking about how men expect sex just because they buy you a meal. And that's the other overriding theme of the album that I really think is driven home with this. So, you know, we have this sort of general inequality. We have her hustle and her desire to work and her pride and her efforts paying off. But then we have the insufficiency of men. Men are mostly insecure, lazy, duplicitous, selfish in this world. And I think it's worth comparing it to Megan Thee Stallion now for a second. Now, obviously, they're very different. And one of my biggest complaints about Megan Thee Stallion is how, no matter how sort of brazen she gets with her sexuality and how much agency she has in her own story, she inevitably goes back to the idea that she is so good at sex that men give her money and buy her things, right? So in that way, these are complete opposites, right? Sorry, I hit my window. They're complete opposites. I have to record close to the window because the light's really bad here. So in that way, they are complete opposites. But in a way, they're similar because they both spend a lot of time making men uncomfortable. Megan Thee Stallion, with her obsession that men who are with her have to have a large penis and a lot of money, this sort of constant implication and direct saying that the men are not good enough. But here, it's the other side of the coin. Men are emotionally stunted. They are entitled babies. So in both of these cases, you kind of put them together, we have sort of a tableau of the insufficiency of men. without it without that being the point of the album, right? That's not the point of this music, but it is one of the themes that seems to be reoccurring. So good. I think men should be made uncomfortable, and so should crackers. Did I mention that I am not representing anybody other than myself? Because it's true. Okay, so thank you again. I'm sorry I forgot who recommended it. You can put it in the comments and say, it was me, because I do appreciate it. As always, all I need to review something is time to review it, which is the hardest thing to find. I have to like it, and I have to have something to say about it that I think is interesting. All right, well, for next time, the people who are about to come in and work on my garage, they're like sanding the garage, so I had to record this video early. There's the camera.